Good afternoon, everyone, and it's always a pleasure to be at the Luxembourg Internet Days. And you mentioned Muddy Waters, and I think we'll talk about that just today, about ransomware attacks. So what I will try to do is to basically explain to you the opportunities you can get from the attacker itself, and to basically monitor what they are doing. And I'll take some example that we encountered for the past year with the ransomware attacks, and I will show you all the adversaries are basically dealing with their own customers and so on and services, and all you can gather information from them. So just quick introduction of what Circle is. Circle is an incident response team in Luxembourg. We are basically supporting and helping organizations in the private sector, in the community, and non-government entities in Luxembourg to face incidents, and we support them on the technical things and all the organizational aspects of incident response. But over the years, what we have seen is a trend of regarding the speed of the incidents, especially in the ransomware attacks. And to counter that, we basically developed two main software. One of those is called MISP, which is an information sharing platform where people can share information, trade intelligence, contextualize information, either operational or tactical. And this is an open source project. But we operate open source communities where people can share actively information about incidents and so on. And at the same time, what we are doing, we are basically gathering information from the threat actors themselves. And that's what I want to show you today, is basically what kind of information threat actors are leaking and how you can use that information to protect yourself. And that's really important. I think you really need to know how the economy of the threat actors are working, or the adversary are working on at scale, and how you could benefit from that to improve your defense. And that's why we are trying to really monitor what the attacker are doing, and we are doing it this on an L platform, which is an open source project too. And it's quite important, because more information we gather, better we are prepared. So I will start with a very simple issue that we had in Luxembourg. So the thing is, give me the next slide. The thing is, with incident, a lot of times it's based on the time. The question of time is really important. And it's a question of time for a lot of incidents, especially for ransomware. And I will mention a specific story that we had in Luxembourg, which was not really what I would say our best experience, but I think we should learn from it. Some time ago, we notified a lot of organizations in Luxembourg about vulnerabilities in VPN gateways. So we basically find a way to reach out to those organizations, notify them by different means, and finding point of contact sometimes can be very painful or difficult. So we were basically sending out emails to some of the vulnerables and potential victims. And that's quite interesting there. So some answer back to us saying that they fixed the issue and so on. Some didn't answer, and that's basically we're expecting them to fix the issue. 10 days later, we receive a request from support from a company in Luxembourg, and what they were facing was a ransomware attack. But the thing and that's really the pity there, we discovered that this company received our emails. At least we send an email to them with the notification that they have vulnerable VPN gateways, but they didn't take any action because they didn't read their email. So that was kind of a, I would say, wake-up call for everyone, saying that, okay, email notification is maybe one way to do it, but I think it's not the best way to do it, to basically get notified. And the thing is, they get the ransomware 10 days later, and the attackers basically use these vulnerabilities. So the intelligence was there to secure the infrastructure, but it was not applied because there was no automated way to get this information, enforce, upgrade, and so on, with to do it before that the attacker is basically taking over. So that's quite important. So intelligence is there, available, but very often it's a question of time. See, if you can answer quickly and promptly, you can fix your infrastructure. And for ransomware attacks, a lot of them, when people are fixing in a prompt way, they are basically secure against such kind of attack. So the thing that is quite interesting too is, if you look carefully at what ransomware attacks are all about, it's looking at what the attackers are sharing, and especially what they are sharing on what they call press release or blog. A lot of ransomware attacks are basically communicating to communicate to the external world, you have really to take that in mind when you have ransomware attacks. The thing is, they need to basically reach out to the victim, and they need to have a kind of trust channel with the victim. Sounds a bit awkward, but at the end, the victim needs to pay, in between brackets, the adversary, which is a kind of supplier at the end. And if you pay the if you pay the attackers, you want to know that you can basically restore your data. So there's a kind of game here, but it's basically an economical game that the attacker has to prove the veracity of the information that he possesses to basically make a kind of level of trust with the victim. And that's quite interesting. So then I will show you some kind of those press blocks. This one is interesting. So it's one of the ransom groups. So those web pages are not directly accessible on the internet. They are on Tor hidden services. They are on, between brackets, what people call dark web. So it's basically pages that are operated by the ransomers to inform about their new leaks, their new targets, and so on. And it's basically websites, and they are trying to do advertising. And if you see on the left side, there's two kind of attacks there. There's the latest, what they call the latest proof. So they are proof that they basically compromise a victim, showing some information and so on. And then you have some latest leak where, for example, the victim refused to pay them, and then they leak the information. You see it's a regular stream of attacks. This website, you have like around 25 groups active in ransomware attacks. One of those is, this one is pretty active. And what you can see there, and you can really get this information from their website, they are not focusing on one country. They are basically focusing worldwide and doing worldwide attacks. So they are basically attacking different countries on a daily basis. And that's interesting too. You can get information about the kind of targets they have. You see a target in UK, you have target in US, you have target in Germany. So they don't really care about the country where you are. They are basically opportunists, and they focus on this kind of easy access to get. So most probably those attacks were due to unsecure VPN, some specific email attachment that were executed by users and so on. But they use usually easy techniques to get into the system. So that's one way. And you have plenty of other groups. So another one, this one is another group that's quite active. Some of the victims there listed are even mentioned in the press. So I just took the one that are publicly announced, so to avoid any issue. But you see that their goal is really to show that they compromise the victims, show that they have the data, and show that they are willing to share this information with others. So that means leaking the information if the victim is not getting in touch with them and so on. Those block of information from the ransomware are used not only for reaching out the victims, but they are used as a kind of advertising to show their capacity of conducting their attacks and being able to restore the data for the victim. So it's a kind of paradox here. At the same time, they are searching for new victims, but they need to send out some information publicly to show their capacities regarding attacks. So another one, and another group which is quite well known is CLOP, which is active. And I took that one because this one is an interesting one. SoftwareAG.com, for example, makes some press release about not being attacked and so on. And then the ransomware groups decided to publish some information, and then they publish directly the leak on their website. And again, you can gain a lot of information about that. So those attacks exist. They are recurrent. I mean, Luxembourg has been targeted like many other countries, and that's why I was mentioning that those attackers are really targeting different groups and different countries. And it's interesting to gather information about how they behave and so on. But you see, this information is indirectly accessible. So if you are monitoring it on a daily basis, you can get more information about the operation of the groups. And for example, on the next slide, you have, on this one is a very interesting group. In addition to reaching and leaking the data, they do additional pressure against the victims. And you see that on the red box there, they say that they are actually doing DDoS attacks against a specific victim. And it's really showing the different way of pressures and showing to us, I mean, to every one of us, what kind of technology they use to basically conduct their business. So it's not a matter of using just one technique or one tool. They are using a combination of different techniques to reach their goal. And that's super important to learn from them. It means that when you secure your infrastructures, being, again, protective against DDoS is basically quite good if you face other kind of attacks at some later stage. So it's interesting, I think, for everyone here to really see how those attackers are communicating to the public and monitoring what they do on a daily basis. So just to show really an example of what kind of information you can get. For example, this one is an interesting one. Electroform company has been compromised. It seemed that they were not dealing with the victim at some point, and they decided to leak some data. So you see that you have a pretty large file with a complete dump. And in addition to that, they even show the complete infrastructures of the victims. So in this case, it was the distinguished names on the Active Directory. You have the operating system they use, names and so on, name of the machine. So they use it as a proof. But again, you can learn something from that. They do lateral movement. So sometimes people say that, okay, ransomware attacks, they compromise one system, just encrypt the data and that's it. That's not true. They really actively do lateral movement on infrastructures to gather information, to see all the weak points before conducting the ransom. And that by just looking at what they are sharing as an adversary, you can get how they operate. And that's again a very interesting point. That means on your internal infrastructures, every single component is super important. Because even if you secure 90% of your infrastructure and you have your two or two weak components, basically you are dead. Exactly that. They are moving to the weakest target they could find in their infrastructures to gather a data and then encrypt it. And then you can see that they have these different kind of models where the ransomware is just a part of the models, but you have models where they compromise information, share with information with other parties. That means other malware authors or other criminals that are using the data, for example, to do some financial fraud and so on. So it's really combined attacks. So by monitoring the attack and how they are behaving and even how the attacker is communicating into the public, you can gather a lot of information that could save you for protecting your infrastructure. And that's, I think, my key point there. So, for example, you have some way of the teams are working. So Maze, for example, we recently stopped their activities for various reasons, and maybe this one could be an interesting talk later on, but they explain how they deal with communication and so on. And that's something that if you have a press team or media team, they should look at it because they explain how they will interact with you and how you have to deal with them. So this kind of information usually is like, okay, it's the attacker adversary information. We should not look too much into it. I think it's a gold mine of information. And even for communicating press release and so on, you should have a look at all the BF because it's a way, if you know to react, you basically kill them on some point too. So it's really, again, a balance to find the proper way of communicating to the outside world and sometimes with the attackers, but that's usually the thing that you don't want. So just to see all those kind of information, you see that the attacker is giving a lot of information, but what can you do? And so that's exactly the thing. It's you need to improve the sharing of information. And that from the small example I took before, we had this situation where a company received an email notification, didn't read the notifications, and then 10 days later, the attacker basically used that vulnerabilities, abuse the systems, get in, encrypt the data, and the company gets ransom. So, and that's the thing that you really have to think about. Are you still exchanging critical information like that through emails? Do you have any single point of failure when the email I receive and so on? And that's usually a major problem. And that's where we could help there, and everyone could help. It's really improving the sharing of information and the real-time exchange of information is really cutting the time for the attackers. And reducing his time is basically improving your way of reacting and making defense. And that's maybe my conclusion for today, is that what can you do? So we have already plenty of sharing communities existing. And I really urge everyone to join one of the sharing communities to get information automatically. I will just mention one. Lukix has a project called PyZax, and this one is super interesting. It's really an information sharing community for the Internet Exchange Point. Those Internet Exchange Points are exposed to some security issues, but they are maybe different than the other, and that's why they set up a community. They are using MIS for that. So if you're an internet exchange point, feel free to get in touch with them. So we have a list of communities that you can reach out. That's on the website. And you, at Circle, you can even reach to us to basically get access to the communities. If you don't have capabilities to do that, that's fine too. It will be interesting that to get in touch with us, to share with us what kind of assets you have publicly on the internet, to know exactly who to contact in case of emergency, when we know about the vulnerabilities. And that's something that sometimes you are wasting a lot of time to find the right contact. So again, if you want to be protected, it's again a matter of time. And the thing is, you have to share before the adversary is basically doing it with other adversaries, because it's super important for you. So just for the contact point, so don't hesitate to contact us on circle.lu, info@circle.lu. If you have already MISP installed and you want to share and get one access to one of our existing community, don't hesitate to reach out. So if you want to be protected, I think the best things to do nowadays is to do automations and get information sharing in the right way. Thank you very much.
Alexandre, thank you for your presentation. Just before you leave us, there's one question which I'm not sure we will be able to cover during the panel afterwards. And that question is, did you also already have cases where the ransom was paid, but the data was not returned, was not decrypted, etc., maybe because it was encrypted by somebody else?
Yes, we have the case. So, and that's a very good question. The question is like, can they keep their promises? Can they decrypt the data? Some are having websites on Tor to prove that they can decrypt the data. Some don't have it. And indeed, sometimes someone pays the wrong group. So they pay someone else, and they basically that group didn't have the key. And usually they don't reimburse you at the end. That's a very good question. Yes, we had cases where and people, for example, organizations don't pay. Sometimes you have organizations that pay because they are really in a bad shape and a bad situation, which sometimes we understand, but usually you should not pay. And then you have really a dirty situation where basically the data were not being recoverable at all, but a payment was done. So you had indeed the three different cases.
Thank you. There is another trend in the market, which you certainly have heard about, Alexandre. That's the fact that some of those ransomers now start making donations to charities, etc., etc. What they will obviously also not give their victims is a tax-deductible certificate. But that was it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.